allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And if everyone could remain standing for a moment of silence. And I'll now call the roll. Committee members Ambrose and Lane are absent. Committee member Grow. Committee member Bradley is absent. Committee member Rokas, absent. Committee member Bergeron.
Present.
Committee member Tessier.
Present.
Committee member Staub.
Here.
Committee member Terrio is absent. Committee member Connors.
Here.
Committee member Beaudry.
Present.
Committee member Avar.
Here.
Committee member DeRocher is absent. Committee member Van Houten.
Here.
Mayor Gatsis is absent. We have a quorum.
Madam Clerk, if I just may, Committeewoman Langton couldn't make it because she has a business, a work schedule conflict.
Sure.
She has a teacher-parent meeting, okay. So I just wanted that noted.
Yep,
thank
absolutely.
You.
And at this point, I'll turn it over to the superintendent.
Good evening, everyone. Tonight, we're going to take a first look at our Smarter Balance scores for Manchester School District. As you'll see, there'll be some big ideas, district scores, state scores, comparisons, school scores, etc. What I would caution you with is we still have not been able to upload in our individual student scores. So what we put up here tonight is the most accurate information that we have right now, but it may change a point or two one way or another once that happens. So we've been told that by the Department of Education. So with that, I would like to introduce two folks who have been doing a lot of work and helping educate us as well as the principals. First, we have Tina Prue, who is a teacher at McLaughlin. Tina is really a leader in this area, very interested, very bright, and has done a lot of looking at or learning about the SBAC, which is very, very different. And then with us is Donna Crook, who's our district data analyst, who also is right in there with working directly with the DOE, uploading the scores, getting the information out. So we hope to go through the PowerPoint, and then we'll certainly entertain questions from the board. And so with that, we'll begin.
So we put together a little bit of an overview of what Smarter Balance is and how it is set up for us, and we broke out the scores by grade, which I think everybody saw that, as well as a press release today from the state and a press release from the school district. So we're just going to jump right in and get going. There's two parts to the Smarter Balance test. There's a summative and a performance task portion of it. So we're going to only be presenting on the summative portion of the test. It's released today in the state of New Hampshire, and it's based on growth data. This year is a baseline-only data, so it's not a comparable test to previous NECAPs or an additional test because it's the first year of the testing. It sets a baseline for what our students should do by growing and looking at individuals based in peer academic groups, which is different from the previous testing that we've done. You really can't compare it to NECAP. They're two complete separate tests based on different standards. The Smarter Balance is an adaptive test, allows a student to actually get harder and harder questions as needed, or back up a little bit maybe to do that, where NECAP was just a set test that was taken. So we really need to cautious actually comparing those two. NECAP was based on proficiency. This is based on the actual career and college ready standards. As part of the test, you saw we actually had about 88% of our students take the test across the district. As the grade levels go up, the actual participation went down, and that was true throughout almost every school. So based on the completion, this is actual completion results by school. They do vary across the school. We've been investigating why some of the percentages are lower at other schools versus their other elementary schools on that, and we understand why those numbers are. So there is definitely participation across. But as you see, the higher numbers are definitely elementary. middle school completion rates, again, this is a combined rate for school. Sixth grade was definitely stronger as it went to eighth grade and actually dropped off. So again, these are averages. And then in the high school levels as well. So, Tina, would you like to talk a little bit about the results that we have in overall grades?
Sure. Here you can see we put a comparative of language arts and math. And in a couple more slides, you're going to see, like Donna said, it's really not a proficiency, but there are still levels in it. And this test is broken into two different sections, and we're going to talk about that in a moment as well. So at the moment, this might not really mean a lot, but these are just overall results. There's an overall score, and then there's a breakout of the claim scores, and we'll talk about what that means in a few minutes. But this is the grade bands, and the blue is the language arts, and the red is the math. And all these are in the PowerPoint packets that you guys have. Here again, we have subject level results for language arts, and this is a comparative to the state averages. So we have the blue is our district, and the red is the state. Same slide again for math, comparative to the state. And this is overall at that grade level. Now this is what I said, maybe it will make some more sense or not. So the way this is derived, like Donna was saying, it's an adaptive test. The test has a lot of components to it. There's an ELA component, there's a math component. Overall, the content scores are the ones that we just looked at, and that's just the big idea of the content. Within the content, what we used to call domains, what they're calling claims now, is broken into four categories for each language arts and math. When we come down lower through the makeup of the way this is designed to look at different levels of growth to provide information to educators, there's pieces that are called targets, and then there's that standard strand as well. So it can be drilled down and up and down a million different ways to help inform educators in curriculum development and assessment development and those kinds of things. But when we look at overall results, we kind of look at the bigger categories. So we look at the subject areas, and then we look at the claims. In math, there's a note that we want to make. There are four different claims, but when we look at the reporting, they've taken the problem solving and the modeling and data analysis, and that gets reported out as one claim because the task that the student has to do or the way that those two claims fit together, you need to do both to solve that kind of a problem. Those are some higher order thinking problems.
And the way we look at this is that the overall subject level is like that 30,000 view. It's what this, we look at as a school district, maybe school-wide, and then as we start breaking down the claims, we can actually start looking at strengths and weaknesses. Though some of the proficiency scores are what we expect, there are some very high claim scores as we go through, so there's things that we've worked on our, based on our standards that we were focused on in the curriculum, that we do see some positive in the numbers. And when we look at across the board, you're like, they're not as strong as you expect them to be. So as we dig down more, that's actually more data that we can use and work with teachers to actually better drive instruction for our students.
And here is what the definition of each of these claims is. Like we said, that's in the packets as well. So it's the kinds of things and the kinds of tasks the students have when they're looking at these claims.
And those are math claims, and then we also have broken out, and again, these are your packet, the language arts claims.
Like I said, we've been teaching a long time, like some of us have. We used to call them domains, so it's looking at those pieces of learning.
So this is all, the test is actually to try to assess the career college ready standards. So previously in the NCAP we talked about level 3 and 4 being proficiency. We can't use that language now, it's out of balance. What we're looking at is how is a student progressing towards the career college ready standards that were laid out. I think it's important to also note that we kind of lost a year in our progress because we spent a year looking at our standards instead of working on our curriculum right away. So we honed in on the Manchester Academic Standards for a year, then we're building the curriculum. So we're kind of building that plan as we're flying. So you have the curriculum, you have the instruction, you have the assessment, but it's all tied back to what standards you're learning. So because of that, kind of, you know, it takes time to do that. So we're a little bit behind for where we expect to be, but we're getting back up in the curriculum now that the standards have been set.
The other thing I'd like to point out, this assessment is something that's a little bit different, and I probably will talk a lot about semantic things because it's that precise word choice that you got to look at to understand the differences. And now that we're looking at understanding and levels and degrees of understanding, that's where the student growth really becomes important, because that's that old depth of knowledge we used to talk about. Well, now we're talking about depth of understanding of a student based on that depth of knowledge. So it's really designed to help us better instruct our students and better inform us on how to instruct our students.
And previously on AYP, it was, here was the bar. Did we jump the bar or not? Which we know there's some great things going on in our schools, and as students are growing, maybe they're moving from the level one to level two, which that would have never actually come out in the NECAP reports, because they're saying this is the bar. Every student has to jump this bar, and not every student is the same. So what we're looking at is a student growing across time, and that's what we're able to get with the Smarter Balance Assessment. So again, this is just another way of looking at the levels.
And the next slide is probably a little bit better. So the big subject level scores, the way it's broken out, the way it categorizes the scores, it breaks it out to four levels. But when we look at the claim scores, it's really, it's a span among, I don't know the exact terminology, but it's when we look at access scores, the kids have a little span of a score that it comes between. So it's not as exact when we're looking at the claims, because it's a lot of open-ended stuff. So when we're assessing kids in an open-ended way, it's in a range. That's the word I was at a loss for. So we're looking at more ranges when we're looking at the claims, which is really a better way to look at it.
And there's a higher standard deviation right now because it's the first time the test was taken. As the test is continually taken, the standard deviation will get smaller because we have a larger sample size. So grade 3, ELA, and math, with the national average being the straight line going through versus the dotted line of the Manchester average based on all 14 elementary schools. I do want to commend our teachers. We only had about 3 to 4 weeks to prepare for the Smarter Balance test last year with some of the decisions being made whether we were going to take it or not. So our teachers were valiant in getting going and getting started in such a short period. And we did have a few issues with some Comcast issues or testing issues in the first day, but it was worked out relatively quickly. And in grade 4, so you have all this in your packet for each grade level. And again, when you start looking at growth over time, I think we have a lot of good things going on versus just where you are in proficiency. So, ELA and math as well. So this is where we actually took the claims for grade 3. We broke down the claims for you as well, so you can actually see areas where we might be stronger in the claims versus the overall. And the individual pieces are weighted, so we might be doing stronger on one claim, but it might not result in the overall numbers because the claim is weighted differently. Different number of questions, different weights on those. It is adaptive test, so it will keep changing over time. And again, there's 3 for the math because those 2 claims are combined. So it's 4 claims each, but they're combined out in 3 claims on the math on the left-hand side.
And the problem solving model.
Right. So you can see that in the packet, and we can get back to the questions after we're done with the presentation. Grade 5. So we're going to jump over to middle school.
Yeah. So here we have, again, the 6th grade, the 7th grade, and the 8th grade language arts. The state averages are up here in the corner, and this is the averages at those grade levels. And this is that overall test itself, just ELA. We'll look at the claims in a minute. And I think we have the math as well. And here's math in the middle school. Again, this is just the big overall content. The state averages are up here. now when we look at the claim scores, and this is kind of what Dawn was talking about, so now we look at this and we're thinking about the data, we're like, well, look at all those claim scores, right? But then look at the overall scores. So what this is telling us at the moment is some students may be very strong in a certain claim, but when they have their whole package overall together, that's why we're seeing what we're seeing over there. So every student is an individual, you know? Something like the math. We have the claims broken out over here and then the overall. And then here's high school.
And none of this is, traditionally we know in math, I think it was actually in the press release today from the state, typically our math is low across the state. It's reflected here in Manchester as well. The claims for math, the ELA.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have several questions that you may. Well, the first question I have is you mentioned that we can't compare this test with other tests because it's the first time. My understanding, we're not going to take this test again next year. So are we going to be in the same predicament next year as we are this year, where we have no real test to compare to because it's going to be apples to oranges? That would be my first question.
To my understanding, it's just 11th grade that was determined to take the SATs instead, and we're still going to do 3-8 unless that's something that is decided for us not to do.
And just to piggyback on that, the SAT was rewritten, I believe, last year. And so the standards that the SAT is written to are the newer standards of education, which are these similar standards that were here. So when they develop the new SAT, the standards are the same standards.
They're going to be Manchester academic standards?
Well,
or Common Core standards?
Well, when we put labels on standards, I mean, they're reading and writing standards. So
we have our own standards that we should be abiding by, not Common Core.
Correct, but their standards are the reading standards. So they're standards for reading and writing. In language arts department, in math, there's standards for problem solving, whatever all the categories. I speak better to language arts than I do math because that's what I've worked with so hard. But so when we developed the Manchester academic standards that we had the opportunity to do, it was actually a great project because we got to look at all of the standards and pull the best of all. And thinking about that student practice and student understanding and that cause effect, we were allowed to put things together in a place that if we develop our curriculum and our assessments and work with it enough over time, this is one data point, right? As a teacher in the classroom, I look at three. I look at the parents and the family, I look at my classwork and my student results, and then I look at a standardized test to kind of keep me in balance. So when you look at those three pieces together, that's going to give you the overall picture to move ahead and move forward. So thinking about, a test and the standards that a test is written to or developed from, you need some common language across assessment development, or else assessments would be all over the place. So thinking about what an eighth grader should know and be able to do in eighth grade is kind of where we need to move with it. And same thing with like the SAT. What they did was they looked at where kids need to be when they're leaving high school to go either into the world of career in today's 21st century or to go to further education. And that's kind of where these pieces are supposed to be helping guide us, just one leg of it.
May I continue? Thank you. Well, on Monday night's meeting, I had a question about the math, because you have units of math, and teachers are skipping from Unit 2 to Unit 8. And the explanation is that the curriculum is not aligned to the standards, so teachers are pulling from what they have to try to align themselves to the standard. So how is that going to play out when it comes to taking a test?
Do you mind if I ask for a couple of clarifications, because I wasn't at Monday night's meeting? So when we're saying the units and pulling from different units, are we saying that in elementary or middle or high school math?
Elementary.
Okay, so if we're thinking about elementary math, and we have some units that were written, we have to think about what that pacing and that progression of the units looks like. Then we may have some resources that are also written in units, and those resource units may not be in the same progression that we in Manchester have decided we thought was the best progression. So that puts a teacher in the position where we move around in those units, in the resources that we're using, to be able to follow the progression that we decided as a district is the best progression. So sometimes when we hear teacher talk, and they talk about it like everybody knows what we're talking about, because that's our world we live in every day, it can create some confusion.
The concern that the parents had is their children are coming home frustrated where, you know, they're doing fractions and they haven't done multiplications or division yet, but they're already into fractions. And they were wondering how that progression, you know, is there a progression that should be taking place, or and is this district-wide, or is this just one school that's doing it this way?
Well, thinking about that with the new research has shown is, so something like multiplication, those fact man things that are automaticity type things, those are better when practiced for a few minutes a day daily over the course of a lifetime if some kid needs it, or education. And those other deeper skills where they have to solve problems together and it's more an interactive thing, those are the things that we sit as the bigger units. So sometimes it's just you know, that as education has developed, we found different ways to do an old thing. And, you know, we'll work through it, and it kind of sometimes gets a little miscommunicated along the way.
I mean, on the page where it says completion by high school, Memorial High School, 34.661%. Is that of the eighth graders, or is that considered the total school?
That's the total school because of the opt-out then.
Yeah, but why would you take the total school? Because only the 8th graders took the test. I mean, 11th graders took the test.
Well, yeah, see, all eligible.
Yeah, it's all eligible people that should have taken the test and the percentage that actually took it. And it's not just 11th graders. It's any 12th grader that didn't take the previous test as well. So there's like 20 or so that might have been promoted in the middle of the year. So
when you look at the high school, realistically, Wester was the best with 56.9, almost 57%. Is that a realistic number to be able to compare our student population? And, you know, why would we spend money on this if they don't want to take the test, is my argument. You have 34% of the kids in a school taking a test. I wouldn't give the test because it really doesn't show a real reflection of the student body.
Well, and that's the issue. Is looking at the school-wide results right now, this is really should be driven for individual student results. And it's going to allow us to actually build what's called academic peer groups. And this is purely anybody who took the test we're looking at for those portions of it. As we go into accountability, what actually counts for a school or a district, there's multiple business rules that have to happen for those students to actually count for the school. So it's the actual reliability of the test right now is going to be lower anyways because it's the first time taking the test. And you'll see that on the actual student individual student reports. You'll see some very large standard deviation numbers on those. So we really need to use the data right now to drive and look at students individually. And then at high school anyways, it's going to switch to SATs. Right. So it's really just a point in time.
I mean, on the grade, I'm looking at grade 3, but on any of them, what is the opinion of the administration as far as language barrier and access to computers? Does that play a dynamic? Because we have schools, as you know, that have language barrier problems, and the test was given English, right? They didn't have an opportunity to give it in any other language, correct?
Okay, so I teach in the program, so I can speak to that. Some of my kiddos took the test. Again, if the student was not here for a complete year, they did not take the reading portion of the test, only the math.
But if they weren't here for more than a year and they still weren't efficient in English, they took the test, correct?
Correct. But the directions, there was a click on there, the directions in math. Well, I think the items in math could be read in their language. The directions in either one could be read to them in another language. So there was audio the headphones and that type of stuff. I mean, my kids took the test just fine for how they were taking it. It was, you know, they sat and took it. I mean, the results, I haven't seen them yet myself, but.
This is that their actual scores taking the test. When we look at accountability, that's when things change. So the subgroups go away with accountability if the state follows the accountability that's been put in place. We create what's called academic peer groups. If everybody in this room scored the same score in fourth grade on the test, we become an academic peer group to see where our growth is for next year. Let's say this half of the room scored, let's say 2400 this year, next year you guys start scoring 2450. We might think that's a great score, but the average state, the average of our academic peer group is actually 2500. This group did not do well, it had low growth. So it takes out the EL, the special ed, it takes all those categories off the table because now we create an academic peer group that grows over time. The next year, the 2450s become another academic peer group, and it's all a modeling piece on that. So I think that's where Manchester is going to actually do very well, because we create the groups and we take the diversity off the table.
What about the familiarity of the computers? There are some schools that have very little access to computers. Their kids may have, you know, a very short period of time in a week to go before in front of a computer, where other students have probably one-on-one computers. So is that figured in? Because I'm assuming some kids taking a test, it's complicated dealing with a computer if you're not used to dealing with it.
Well, yeah, and like we said, this is baseline at the moment, so whatever it means in these results. Hearing some of the principals talk, they actually felt that this was actually a good result of taking this assessment, because we were able to get some technology access points in the buildings, and it really put a light on it. So now kids are using those resources on a daily basis this year, which really worked out very nice, actually. And we're able to do some things that we weren't able to do before with our instruction in the classrooms. So, and as we can keep building that, you know, it takes time to build those resources into the district, that it only can benefit the kids to have those at their disposal, if no matter how we had to get them here, right?
So using last year's scores, yes, but this year we're actually doing more things. We're going to try to do the 3-to-1 initiative that Jeff DeLange and the IT department's doing. So we were working on that because we know those are skills that our students should have, regardless of whatever standards we're working on. So there could be some of that, but.
I have two more questions, Mr. Chairman. When you mentioned the claims, math and ELA claims, Ms. Langton asked at the meeting Monday night that there are some that only have one question, and if you answer that question wrong, that whole area is wrong. Now, can you explain that exactly? How much of that happened? Because it was our understanding that you were going to start out with simple questions in your grade level and then progress to harder questions as you move along. But if there's only one question for that one area, how does that work out?
It's not one question per claim. Yeah.
Just in speaking to the test itself, it's a different kind of a test. We currently, and I'll speak more for middle school because I haven't looked recently at the elementary assessments, but I know they're doing like reading, writing, workshop model, and I think I've seen actually some interns that I work with at UNH have given me some models of the math that they've done, where there's a lot of literacy built into math literacy, and not only ELA literacy, but literacy is across all content now. So the way these assessments are designed, one question or one performance task could have many components. There could be a video that they've listened to, or a reading that they have read to them, or they read. There could be, it might be just an open-ended question that they're responding to. So the kind of test that we're giving when we say it's a one-question thing, it's probably being scored on a rubric, which gives the student or whoever's taking the test an opportunity to gain understanding and levels of understanding of this one type of test item. So they're different than old-fashioned test items where you just kind of like fill in the bubble, there's only one right answer. The way education's moving now, a lot of things are, and that's why they've moved to this argument claim thing, a lot of evidence-based discussions that you have. So we're trying to teach kids how to solve problems in the world, right? So that means that they have to be able to pull evidence, they have to be able to cite evidence, they can't just, there's not just one answer. Maybe multiple answers could be right, depending on how they approach it, and if they cited the right evidence to it. So it's a different kind of test. I don't know if that helps at all.
Doesn't help me.
I'm sorry.
But if you look at the bottom, it's the standards, multiple standards, and the multiple standards make up multiple targets. So if you get down to the granular of like one line, it might be able to count by to 100 by fives. That could be one stand, you know, one question on that. So it all builds up and it all relates and it's all a progression that builds into targets, which then again builds into claims and then subjects.
My last question for right now would be, under the grade 11 ELA, I noticed that those scores are much higher than the grade 11 math. And I don't know if anybody can answer, maybe Dr. Livingston or Ms. Martin's been around long enough. Is this due to the fact that our reading and writing language arts was separated? This would have been the last group of kids, I believe, that had reading and writing separate. What's your opinion on that? Because that really stood out to me when I looked at that and saw those numbers that much higher.
We could assume that correlation. The other thing that we probably need to look at that I don't have the expertise on at the moment is what courses are kids taking 9th and 10th grade in math? Because depending on the math courses they're taking an assessment that has a set of information on it, skills and standards. If I haven't had those courses that lead up to that yet, I may not be able to answer those questions on that test or may not have the knowledge to answer the questions on that test. So I think there's two things. I think that part of what you said is true. We want to believe that in middle school anyway. That some of the hard work paid off. But, you know, it could be that. And then that other piece of it, because language arts is, you know, more continual. Math has some really discrete courses in high school, different than if you take 9th grade and 10th grade English. Math, you could take a variety of different things and only focus on a certain set of skills. And so that's a different piece.
And that was true of the last NECAP, is that the amount of students in 11th grade that hadn't even taken Algebra 1 yet, they were taking Algebra 1A, they were taking pre-algebra, basic skills, foundation, that they had not even gotten to the content that they were being tested on. And I assume that this is probably, we haven't gotten to that data yet, but I would assume that it's part of it as well.
I'd be interested in that, because how does a student get to the 11th grade without taking Algebra 1?
Because it's based on credits.
I mean, you have students coming out of middle school now going into algebra.
They can, but they also fill out the course sheet themselves. They can choose other courses. So that's, you know, that's something maybe in curriculum instruction we can look at.
And those are things that we're trying to do by bringing in higher classes, the AP courses, and pushing our students into higher performing. So that's something that has been changing with our guidance and our training that we're working with them. Is with the PSATs, we know which students have a better chance of performing. So we're raising that bar for all of our students. So hopefully that will increase across time.
I mean, now that you said that, I distinctly remember when Ms. McGorry came before CNI a few years back, saying I believe it was over 50% of the students were failing Algebra 1. Mm-hmm. And well, I don't know why that happens, but that was...
I was there that night. That was a late night that night. I do remember that.
No. Thank you.
Questions?
Yeah.
I had a question about the variation between schools and the variations between grade levels and how many students took the test. I wondered if you guys had further thoughts on what might have caused that and what may be going on.
I don't know the appropriate way to phrase it, but it was kind of a choice thing this year. Mm-hmm. You know, so that was left up to families for family choice. So.
It's just interesting to see between the schools and kind of figure out what's going on, why, for example, Smith Road is so different than Greenacres.
The one thing that we did find out about Smith Road, because we looked at that number, is that there was a group of students that from one of the programs that did not test. So, and this is purely Smarter Balance testing. This does not include what's called the DLM test, which is the test that's taken for students in special education that are probably not at the level to take the test. So some of the schools that might have a higher percentage might not be, would not be included because they didn't take this test.
I know that the district has been trying to get away from the federal government in the last at least 4 years to see if we could not test students that have not had an education in their own language, and maybe have only had an education in English for 2 years. Is there any way to extract those children from these scores to see if we did have a waiver, what they would look like?
Well, we can definitely do something like that, but the issue is what's nice about this new testing and the new accountability model, it's no longer clears the bar. Also, if students don't score a certain percentage on the access test to show if they have English proficiency, their scores do not count, their access scores. So accountability is different than where they are on these tests. And it's, I think it's important, in my personal opinion, that we test those students where they are, but we don't necessarily hold them accountable for the content if they don't understand the language yet, but we do, we can see progress over time, and they will be grouped with their peer academic groups. We get the biggest bounce, or we did with the NECAP on AYP from the second year with their EL students after they test out. So we know once they understand the language, their content knowledge is very strong. So this actually takes that kind of off the table with the new accountability model.
But are they in those percentages?
This is any student. They walked into school the day we took the test, they had to take the test. So those students are not necessarily accountable to our school for accountability purposes, but it's everybody who took the test that day. So if they moved in the day before, if they moved out the day after, if they only were there the
with
whole school year.
With the exception of the first year reading for language learners.
If they choose not to have those students test. So this includes everybody. Because this is just that, you know, originally with the NECAP, in February we get the NECAP results out. And then that's everybody who took the test during the test in the year. So that includes everybody. So when we do accountability, that's where we can actually look at how the data and what our schools are doing with the students. And those students wouldn't count if they didn't have a certain level of understanding of the language.
Is that why some of those numbers at Bakersville and Beach Street are so low?
Well, these are just completion numbers.
I understand.
Oh,
I'm looking at your other charts that you showed at 8% and 24% and 9%.
What, 17?
We are
looking at
completion, right? So we're looking at
Bakersville. Keep going, the horizontal track, like all the schools. Horizontal track, all the schools.
For the elementary, grade 3, grade
yep.
4.
Grade 3, grade 4,
okay.
Grade 5.
All right.
Keep
thank
going.
You.
Now that's it, yeah.
Well,
these results are typical of what the NECAP results are, of when they actually took the test. There's also things that happened that was out of control of Beach.
Yeah.
For instance, Beach took it the very first day of their first school to test in our district as well as Central, and there was an issue with the test that we didn't find out till the night where they had to retake the test the next day. So there was a little bit of that. Beach was also in the middle of a testing environment where they lost all internet access. So we had those students in the middle of a test situation. So that we had to, so these students have gone through you know, some traumatic events in part of the testing. So,
but then is it fair to put their numbers up there? If those problems happen, why would we show them there?
This is just purely, everybody took a test. When we look at accountability and pull these out, I think we'll have a better understanding.
When are you going to do that?
Well, it's the state will do the accountability at the end of this year.
But what do they use for measures for accountability?
There's multiple measures for accountability. So let's say a student last year scored a 240 score. So if they didn't do well this past year, this is given 1 point in time, chances are if I scored a 5 on a test, I have a much better chance of getting a 25 the next year. So that'll be a huge growth. So we should see a little bit of a bump in those schools just because they started off so low. Does that make sense? Like if I don't do well on a test, I take the next test.
So the John Q. Public's going to look at that. And if I had a child that was going to either Beach Street or Wilson, I'd be asking why. And if you're telling me that accountability in the state's going to take that up, then that's a different measure of testing. Because those scores or those percentages are unfair to those schools.
This is just one test. We also have districts. Okay.
Still unfair. School gets a bad reputation. Any member comments?
How will individual student scores appear to a parent? Will they see a 1, 2, 3, 4, or will they be able to have a total number so they can compare their own student to the city average and to the state average?
It is a total number.
Yeah.
We test up individual student reports with some information about what the test will look like. It is purely a number. So in this example, it's 2571. We'll show you where they fall on the thermometer. It's nice about this test as well. It's on one thermometer. So a third grade student could actually score at 11th grade level if they were able to do it in that test. So we are in the process of working with the state on getting these copies and printouts. So this went to ELA. It also shows what the average is of the school and the average of the district. But one thing to keep in mind is that the standard deviation is going to be higher too. So a student could swing between two levels on the first test.
And the only other thing, not to interrupt you, but so the kid will get, it's not like the old 40, if you're in 8th grade it was an 840 or whatever. It's just a pure number, and the number continuum starts from the beginning of testing at the beginning of 3rd grade to the end of testing at the end of whatever the continuum ends up being. And wherever you fall in that number is where it's been adapted for you. So maybe you score a certain number, and then it might be a proficiency of the end of 4th grade, but you're at the beginning of 5th grade or something like that. So it's just one
continuum. So if I have a 5th grade student, I should be able to see if my child is behind and is scoring more at 3rd grade level.
Absolutely.
Or if they're ahead and is up by the 8th grade.
Absolutely. Which is like old fashioned. When we had the old reading in elementary school, and I sat before, who's my principal, which makes me uncomfortable here. but we used to give those benchmarks often with the kids. And it was kind of nice because you could move kids' reading levels and you could really focus on it. So, I mean, some years I was able to move a kid 2 grade levels in a year with that information in my hands, and it was really actually a nice thing.
Thank you. I have a few questions. One of the things that always astounds me, even though participation rates are low, and this went through NEAP and UCAP as well, that we're coming out of middle school, we're way behind, but by the time our kids get to 11th grade, we've made up a lot of ground in terms of what the state averages are, both in math and in language arts. So I just think that, you know, kudos to our high school teachers. The second thing is, I know that this is just a baseline test, but do you think you'll be able to use this information to ID areas that need development? For example, geometry or whatever, if kids are not doing well in a particular target or claim or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And if you say, find something like in third grade geometry, there are issues. How do you address that? What kinds of things will you do going forward to help teachers and adapt the curriculum so that that those things are going to be?
And that's exactly it. That's why we have curriculum committees right now who are reviewing ongoing. We just put out our MAS standards. We're just writing our units. You've got to teach them a few years. Look back, keep going back and forth, revising. We're on our third revision for our middle school language arts units, and thinking about moving forward. We've made some adjustments and changes across contents and stuff. And for me, looking at some of the claims, I've looked at them very deeply in different ways. There's some actually positive glimmers in there, things that we really focused on because they were new pieces to our curriculum, were actually some of the pieces that came out a little bit higher. And so that was just a little piece saying, oh wow, we are really moving in the right direction, so we can keep building on that. So my perspective looking at some of this stuff, I like looking at the claims better than I do the overall pictures. I think that really is talking about the kinds of things that we're doing on an ongoing basis with kids that are more reflective of our standards that we've created. So this kind of helps give us, so we relooked at a few things. You know, maybe we need to change our rubric, or maybe the unit we didn't quite use the right thing in it, or the right piece, or maybe we misinterpreted the standard in math, and we'll rewrite that unit that goes with that in math. So this is the information that will help guide us through that in that sense.
I also know that the test is administered differently at different schools, in part because of access to computers. For example, I know there was one principal who would not test his kids in the afternoon. But there are others who would test their kids in the afternoon. Are you going to look at how those kinds of things might have impacted the scores, and maybe make some recommendations to principals based on that?
To really look at that in a non-biased way, you'd have to do an action research study, right? So you would have to look at that over time in a variety of times. You can't look at it in one instance. So, you know, I don't know if we're up for putting an action research study out in our district for things like that, but I would lend more to, in my mind, if I was overseeing the principals, I would think the principals know their buildings really well. They know their student population. They know what's going on, so they make those decisions based on that kind of information. So what might not look like it's the same or equal across schools is really the equitable thing to do. You know, maybe one school knows that their kiddos don't do well in the other in the afternoon, and another school knows that theirs does, you know, do really well in the morning, or maybe it's a flip-flop. I have a lot of late kids in my school, so I'm going to test in the afternoon. We really have to leave that open for those kinds of things, because that's really the, you know, the student-centered approach is what we want to do, or our school community approach type of thing.
Are we going to be able to compare our results to school districts in other states? Because I know that the Smart Balance Assessment is being used in lots of different states.
The district is putting it out. Are they doing like they did in the old one where you could click on and make it?
Yeah, we're not exactly sure how the state is going to roll information out, but we did meet with someone who had knowledge of the other 30 states that took this.
Mm-hmm.
So we're hoping to see those results and see if it matches. What's nice about this test, it aligns more with the NAEP testing, and which one reason, because the NAEP scores are actually 20, 30 points better than our NAEP scores, and we know our NAEP scores nationally do very well.
Mm-hmm.
So we have worked and we've asked for that data for state-to-state comparison, so hopefully we'll be able to provide that.
And just one last question. The students who opted out, part of the student-focused approach to using this information, you know, where this establishes a starting point for students, and then you decide from there, you know, which cohort they're going to be in, what kinds of, you know, specific targeted help they might need based on what. What happens to kids who didn't take the test?
Just one piece of the triangle, right? So we just don't have that piece to look at. So we have other pieces to look at. And, you know, when we take out one piece, then we're at 50-50. But that's okay. We can work, you know, we work with what we need to work with.
It does affect our district because they will count as a zero in our district accountability. So it is harmful to us, and we wish every child would take the test and student would take the test. So it gives us a little opportunity, because one thing that we noticed when looking at the test, some of our higher performing students didn't take the test. So now, just as I want to know that a lower performing student is growing over time, I want to know that my student that has been outperforming his peers but continually outperforming his peers. So it's not just the ones to twos, but also the fours and fours moving up, or the threes moving to fours. So, you know, I really do hope that everybody would take the test, because there is so much information in that and see it happen in peer groups.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions? I see a committee member Van Houten.
Thank you. I didn't realize that non-test takers would be capped to zero. So that gave us a black mark to begin with, because so many youngsters opted out. One quick question about the completion. Is that all opt-out students, or did some of our students fail to complete the test?
There is some failure to complete the test, but it's very minimal to, there's no such thing as opt-out. So, yes, it includes everybody that should have taken the test.
And so we reflect less well because of students who didn't take the test. And I assume that I'm correct when I say that our scores reflect less well because the Manchester academic standards are not truly in harmony with the standards upon which the test was produced.
There'll be a few standards that are up in for the test, and a few things that we didn't do that's on the test, so there's a little bit with that. And as we can dig down to the claims and the targets, we can see, you know, definitely targets that we didn't teach because they weren't part of our standards. So there's definitely data to look at that. And it goes back to what counts against us. There's certain business constraints that have to happen for that student to count against the school. They have to be a 90% ADM, or they have to be in the school, meet a certain score in the access score. So if they jump between two schools halfway through it, it might not count against the schools, but it would count against the district. So there's a lot of different things that play in what actually the students actually count against us for not taking the test. So.
I would still think, too, about it being the first time we took this kind of a test. So we're not really sure. In a baseline, I wouldn't really think about if we should go and redraft our standards or not yet. I think that needs to sit over time. We need to really think about that because, you know, like Committeeman Baudry had said, you know, using the new technology, or there could be other factors in play, so we have to kind of let it just sit a little bit for a while before we make decisions like that.
And my question wasn't related at all.
No, I'm just asking, yeah.
The standards.
Yeah.
I know that they're still somewhat in their infancy and growth is being shown there, so I don't want that to be the perception.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Committee Member Bergeron.
Thank you. I guess to build upon the numbers we see for participation or completion on the high school level, how is this sold to students, I guess is what I'm saying. I'm not sure if anybody knows, or what were the recommendations?
I
have a reason for asking based on some of the feedback I've heard. So.
Well, I don't think we sell a test. I think we have to think back to last spring and just think about the community response to the assessment and whatever families chose. And there's really nothing to speak to about it. It just is what it is.
And if I may follow up, I guess what I'm saying is, like you're saying today, you know, how it can be an advantage to a student to know these things, I'd like to think that was mentioned as well to the students, regardless of community feedback, when they're here, you know, what are they hearing based on this? And that's, guess what, I was curious about. You know, are they hearing that, you know, these won't count towards your grades, so, you know, whatever, who cares? Or, you know, are they being presented with a full story as to, you know, the fact that it could tell a story and how it could help?
Right.
And because that, to me, is the beginning of it all. You know, if you don't get their buy-in.
Right. I just think that's a decision we have to make as a district on how we're going to embrace or not. As a teacher, we have to be non-biased, right? So we just...
So there were no best practices, or there were no similarities between schools as to how to present it. It was simply opt-in or opt-out. So there's nothing that, all right, well, you're answering my question by not knowing.
Know.
Okay.
Can we go back to the grades 3, 4, and 5?
Sure.
Subjects
or things?
I would ask if there are some irregularities that happened in the test, I would hope that they would be identified so that people would know that those schools had something happen. And not that they're at 7% or 8%, because when you look at that, there's certainly a degree of concern. So I would say that maybe those two levels should be on two different pages of it, ask what's underneath them, to talk about why those numbers at Beach Street, at West, at Wilson are different. Because if you're telling me that the computers didn't work, then somebody should be told that before the public just got that, and the press gets it, because when they see those numbers, they're not going to have any idea that computers didn't work, or the test went off, or whatever happened. And we're right back into looking at schools that having a tough time on testing. Mm-hmm. And I think that's unfair to put that burden on the schools. And I don't know if there's other things that happen in other schools, because I look at Parker Riding, and here we have the school of the year in an innovation zone that are doing some great things, and their numbers are pretty low.
This is based on where the bar, this is not based on where the bar is with a kneecap. So some of those students are growing and growing tremendously. Are they making up 3-4 years in the first year? Mm-hmm. Again, this is a point in time and a baseline. I'm assuming that there's a psychological effect to students who take a test and have to retake it or the computers go down, but that we still had a 92-93% completion rate at Beach. There's a lot of factors that affect a student every day to take the test. They don't have breakfast, they work late, the stressful events of that. So it's hard to look into everything and think of what could have affected those numbers. Again, this is a baseline data point. So if we have this repetitive over time, then there's things that we have to dive into.
And that's wonderful to talk analytically. Okay? as far as I'm concerned, students aren't part of analysis. They're students that are trying to learn and progress through the system. And we can sit here and use all that analytical data, and that doesn't tell a parent anything other than I'm sending my child to a school that's at 7% when the state average is at 55. Or here we are named the school of the year and we're at 17% and the state average is at 55. I can't talk about analytical data because I'm only looking at bar graphs. So somebody needs to peel back those bar graphs and put language and terminology that parents are going to understand and the public's going to understand. Because looking at those, you don't have a lot of faith in the school district. And I know it's a snapshot and it's one day in time, and those are all wonderful things to say. But those are the numbers you're looking at.
And that's when we have the district assessments. I mean, there's other pieces that we do to see the whole picture of the school.
But you don't have, once you put this on a piece of paper, and they're out there watching it, you don't have an opportunity to say, oh, by the way, we've got something else coming in next week. So all of that scrubbing should have been done before this was presented to the public. Because I really have a deep concern about what this says about our educational system in the city of Manchester. And I know it's just one spot in time, but that's what people are seeing. And there is no other data that people can talk about behind that. Many member Bodie and comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree with you wholeheartedly on that, because when these numbers go out in the paper, that's what people are going to see. I just want to be on the record that we have awesome teachers in this district, and they're doing a phenomenal job with what we give them to work with. And our students are learning. But a question I have, if you look at this bar graph in a perfect world, I'm looking at grade 3, but the school district, our objective is to have everybody read at grade level by grade 3. So if everyone in our district was doing that, would that bar graph all be 100% in a perfect world? How would that look?
If they can read fluently by grade 3, that's just the word common piece. So if kids are doing that, these are questions that maybe they have to respond in a different way. It's the comprehension piece is what's being measured here. So it could or couldn't, I don't know. We would have to wait and see.
Does this test show that, though? Are you going to be able to pull that information out?
That would be classroom stuff that a teacher would do for analysis on that. And I don't know about that piece that you just talked about all students reading on grade level by grade 3. But that's in the strategic plan. Developmentally, I don't know if that is possible.
I believe, Dr. Livingston, that's a goal of the district, isn't it?
It is.
For it's a good goal. It's a good goal.
For 6 years,
no,
it's been
goal.
That goal.
It is a good goal.
And reading is one claim, one of the four claims within the ELA. So we could actually break it down to claim. When the strategic plan was actually put together, it was put together with a kneecap. So now we have to adjust those to affect what we have as an assessment tool.
It depends on what we call reading, too. Right. If it's word calling or if it's comprehension, that's two different pieces. So.
Well, if we can pull that out, because personally, if somebody is not reading by their grade level, I don't know how they can how they can take a test efficiently if they can't read the questions.
Any member comments?
Go ahead. I was going to say that there's kind of another way to look at it and make sure that I'm saying this correctly. Children come to school, they have certain knowledge. Some kids have come to school with the ability to read on day one. Some children come to school and they've not held a book or literally don't know how to turn the pages. So if you looked at those children and you put them on a chart, you would show that some children are here in their learning and some are here in their learning. What will happen next year, which is an advantage to our district and a more fair playing field, is that it's going to watch that child who could barely turn the pages of a book and see how far we've been able to bring that child in 1 year. So, in fact, this is what happens. A child comes in and we
take them 2 years further. Not just one, but we take them 2 years further. Now the district and the teachers actually are rewarded in a sense. Our district is rewarded because we've shown that we could grow a child 2 years, even though they may not be at a level two yet. That is what I didn't like about the NECAP and other standardized testing, is because it didn't let our kids be on a level playing field. This does a much better job of doing that. And that's what our teachers do. They take in kids and they move them huge amounts. And before, you could move them all you wanted and they were still failing. And that's why also you see, as we go through the grade levels, our kids are catching up. It's the catch-up game.
I mean, Mr. Schmidt, I can make a comment.
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you.
Committee member Connors.
She just explained exactly what I was going to ask.
Committee member Logan.
Thank you. That's why I have a problem with evaluating our teachers under this scenario, because we are bringing students ahead. And you can't blame a teacher for the amount of advancement a student has. And how do you know what teacher gave that student the knowledge for that advancement? So that's why I'm hoping that whole evaluation part goes away, because I don't see how you can evaluate teachers on tests.
Anybody else? I would hope.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
I think I have four questions, and I guess one of them is based off part of what the mayor was saying in explaining things. Like, for example, I'm sitting here thinking about the audience at home and the parents or whatnot, people watching it later, hearing standard deviation, and I'm hearing a lot of late terms. I'm wondering, will there ever be a possibility of presenting this either on a student level to students so they understand it, and perhaps to people that don't live in this world every day, as you kind of referenced earlier? Is that a possibility? Because I just feel that would be important, you know, even to new board members coming in, or just relative, and I don't know whether that's not necessarily the way you can explain the low numbers. That's not kind of what I'm referencing, but just so people will understand, you know, talking about the different claims and the fact that our standards may affect that and how that may compare to the state, you know, all kinds of information like that. So I don't know if that's a possibility, and I'll follow up with another one.
Yeah, let me adjust. So in thinking about that, mm-hmm. which is like that actually happened in my classroom today, so in thinking about that at the teacher level, no, we had our first quarter district assessments that we gave last week for our performance task. And so I had gone over them, and so every student in my class, I set a goal. And it wasn't about talking in this manner, it was more, so for the next 4 weeks, you're not going to write with pronouns anymore, because you use too many pronouns, and I don't understand what you're trying to say. And for the next 4 weeks, you're going to back up every statement you make with two more sentences so you can explain more to me. So at the student level, I break down the standard into exactly what you just said, a goal that they can attain and reach. In thinking about our elementary report cards that have that beautiful narrative piece on it, to me, that's that communication piece that goes home that would tell those things that a student needs to work on, or it's the parent phone calls, or those types of pieces. So that's, I think, how it ends up looking and happening in a real basis within the schools and communicating across that way. You know, this is one presentation on some data that we're just putting it out there and answering questions about it. So I don't.
So there's not a possibility that could happen to sort of present it at either a student level and or layman level?
Yeah.
I mean, is that something that
so you'd like a different presentation here?
Or just someone to explain like a lot of the little pieces, you know, what is standard deviation? How does that affect it?
Yeah.
Plus or minus, you know, different things like that. Just,
sure.
I mean, it's just a suggestion I have that maybe
that
it might, especially the first time.
Yeah.
And we're all learning. This is the first time the test is taken nationally. On one of the individual student reports that I passed out to in the bottom left, right-hand corner, there are some really good parent guides and resources as well. We provided some of those on the website, but those are things that we can, they provide us a lot, but we can definitely make things. As we educate our teachers and our teachers educate our parents and PTOs and we've been educating our principals the last couple of years, so it is a learning curve for us from the individual student.
At Green Acres, were the students that are in the deaf and hard of hearing, were they tested or not?
They were tested.
Was there a group of students at Green Acres or Smith Road that weren't tested?
I am aware, digging through the data, that there's one group of students that almost everybody opted out of from the program.
In the elementary schools?
In the elementary school.
Can you tell me what schools they are?
Well, I'm aware of Smith because their numbers were the lowest. We're going to find out why.
And their percentages were the highest?
Their percentage was the highest. 39 students did not take the test.
Right, but I'm looking at Smith Road School in grade 4. And I'm looking at them as being 58%, 53%, and then if I look at grade 5, they're 78%, 48%. And then in grade 3, they're at 52 and 36. So I'm looking at those and saying, and Green Acres is the same. So what's the anomaly from an analysis data of what's causing those numbers to be that high?
We'd have to look into the data more. There was about 39 students that didn't test. So where were the scores of the other tests? There was 120.
When you say didn't test and they get zeros, they couldn't have gotten zeros then either.
They got zeros. They didn't count these percentages.
Well, then the scores must have been off the charts if they got
scored
as zero.
They typically are at those schools when you look at the previous score.
Right, but even if those kids sat in and took the test and did poorly on it, the number would be much higher than 78%.
It's a weighted average when you get from the claims and the targets, but I believe there was only one student that scored, if I recall correctly, that didn't score. I mean, it was something very strong. I'll have to double check my numbers because we looked at so much data, but we looked at that same number too, and the numbers were extremely high, and the students did very well. And it's weighted, so just because they're not strong in research, the reading could have been very strong and it could have carried the scores higher. So it's not just a 25, 25, 25 across the claims that make up the whole subject.
Well, I would hope, and I'll make the motion if we need a motion, but somehow these come back and the numbers are looked at, and if there were problems that happened at the schools, because I look at the fifth grade math scores, I mean, I look at that, and we're not anywhere close to the state average, and my bet is that the numbers there's got to be something that's popping up that's happening. Because there's no reason why the fourth grade or the fifth grade would be going lower than the fourth grade.
And we didn't do any, we started 3 weeks before the test was taken. We had no chance to do the interim testing over the year. There's a lot of things I think put the schools in a position that we had to kind of hit the ground running. So where other districts might have done the interim testing in the fall, we weren't able to do those. So they weren't familiar with the testing, they weren't using the headphones, they weren't familiar with the way the questions were being written. So there's a multiple things. But yes, we can definitely dig into all the differences with the data.
Well, I will direct all the phone calls to Donna. For the parents that will be calling for analytical explanations. Because I certainly can't get into them, and I appreciate the explanation that you gave me while I was sitting here. And I applaud any other board member that might have a clear idea of what you truly said. Because I truly don't know what you said. And I'm not saying that in an offensive way. I'm just saying that if I'm sitting here and I'm hearing it, who's ever listening to it back home, and any of those students that might have families that certainly come from those other schools, they're going to be asking questions like, we remember voting in Congress.
Thank you. One step further, Mr. Chairman, if we can. I agree we should take out the problems that we had in those schools, but also, is there a way to do these numbers by taking out the opt-out or the refusal people so that you take the actual number of students that took the test, take out the zeros, and see what that school has done with the people that took the test?
Yes, we do have the raw data.
Okay, because I'd be interested to see what that looks like without all the zeros in it. Thank you.
Yeah, but the only problem, maybe you're voting, is that you're not, you won't have an opportunity, or none of us will have an opportunity to talk about that at a later date. The only thing anybody's gonna see are these numbers on the front end. Committee member Connors, and that's why they should have been scrubbed before we sat here and had this meeting. Committee member Connors.
First of all, I don't think that those zeros are going to have an effect on these percentages, because this is not the average. A student didn't get like a 78%, am I correct? It's 78% of the students who took the test scored a 3 or 4.
I believe the zeros
are dragging down.
Well, zero would just be...
Zeros have to affect. They have to affect. If you had 10 kids who got 0 and 10 kids who got 80, what does that do to the numbers?
Well, that it's not 80% though, it's the number of students you said that scored a 3 or a 4. So 78% of students scored a 3 or 4, and you had 10% who got zeros, those 10%, or that part of that 22%.
She'll give you the answer right now.
I was going to say, when in elementary, we had something like a 95, I can't remember the numbers. 93% of our students took the test in elementary, so it would have to take a lot of zeros to affect those numbers. So, which...
Okay, so are these percentages that we're seeing the average score, or the number of kids that scored a 3 or a 4?
I'm questioning myself. I
think it's the number of kids that scored a 3 or 4.
So if 78% of students scored a 3 or 4, then the kids who didn't take it are part of the 22% that didn't score a 3 or 4. So it shouldn't affect it.
The only, and we'd have to double check with where this data was pulled from, because that slide that we showed earlier, there's two ways it gets reported out. One of them has a 1, 2, 3, 4. The other one only has 3 bands. So it depends on which one of those two you guys spoke from.
And then my other question for you is, I've seen a lot of test results from other tests across the country, and they always talk about how socioeconomics affect test scores that we see. Do we have the socioeconomic data from our different elementary schools to be able to look at that in comparison to test scores as well?
We can run it by that data. This is the point in time where the test, and then when you do accountability, they'll be put in academic peer groups, and they'll be reported back out in subgroups, but they'll be compared against anybody who scores in the same range. And we won't have that until the next test as the baseline. But that is definitely a cheating gap in what we've been focusing on the last couple of years, so focus on the groups. We could run the data anyway at this point after we have the data.
Anybody else?
I just really quick want to go back to, I'd like to have that information, because I'm looking at Memorial. They have the largest opt-out, and you look at their scores, and they're the lowest of all the 4 schools. So that's why I'm hoping that the zero did count. So I would like to have that information.
Committee Member Bergeron.
Thank you. These questions are just more or less to clarify some of the confusion that I had along the way. And then Connors actually answered 2 of them just a moment ago. But so I guess this is true or false or whatnot. So more than one question make up a claim. There is more than one question that make up a claim, correct? Okay, thank you. And more than one question comprises a score. So it's not only one question. But I just want to make sure everybody's clear that's not here. And within a claim, and I'm talking in terms of strengths and weaknesses. So you're saying basically there's items that are reported that are, would a weakness actually show up in some of the scores in the claim? Or for example, does it show if there's a strength that a student has or a weakness, or is that all sort of coming together?
Again, you can't look at it in one assessment. You have to look at the pieces. So if, for example, let's talk about a student who, over time, can't pick up the main idea of a passage. So we're going to see that piece of it over and over and over again. Not based on just in one instance. So throughout the test, maybe it looks at that 3 or 4 different ways. And then they get their overall claim for that. That's why I said, when you look at the claims, to me there's some really great things happening within here based on some things that I know happened in the units in the rewriting of the standards. So it's kind of cool to look at it that way. You know, we added argument writing and close reading, picking out evidence, different things that we started to do in this new, in the new units and the new rewrite of our documents, our standards and everything. There's some blowers here that kids were doing a really good job in that, as a whole group.
But not as part of the individual testing. Like you were saying, pronouns, now you're not going to.
Yeah,
where did that information come from? Were you actually applied that?
From the district assessment that I just gave.
Okay.
So I found that.
Not necessarily this, like I won't look at the individual scores and say, wow, you know, strengths here, but opportunities for improvement or what?
Once we get the student results, depending on how it comes to us and how we're able to drill down, there in the old kneecap drill down, I used to be able to look at things like that in Performance Plus for a student. I don't know how this is going to be reported.
So it'll be an individual that will decide to be proactive to drill down. It's not drilled down automatically in some report individually for a student.
It takes
a little proactive.
Okay. It never was.
Yeah. So I'll be proactive. All right,
that's part of our professional development.
That we have data teams at each school that will take a claim and look through if that's what their goal is for their SLO or their student learning objectives for the school, and to dig down in these numbers and see what the strengths and the weaknesses are.
Thank you.
Having had two kids go through the school system, one of the things that always astonished me was that if my child took the NEAP test in third grade, that information was not given to the fourth grade teacher, which always seemed to me like, you know, although it's just one day, it might give you an indication of where the strengths and weaknesses of a child are.
Mm-hmm.
So are the results of the third grade test being passed on to the fourth grade teacher now?
Everything's in a file folder. You could go through and look for your, like you would any student. You know, it depends on practice, right? Some people like to look at the beginning of the year, other people look a long way. It's all there.
We have a system through the state called Performance Plus where all the data gets loaded up, so all the kneecap, all the access, attendance, all that stuff gets loaded in, and we've been working with the state data coaches to come into our schools, particularly at the elementary level, to train our teachers how to go into that data and look at it. So it's something that's been ongoing, and we're doing so many pieces at the same time, that's standards for curriculum and instruction, because now we have to start using best practices and instructions to start showing the curriculum. And we need to stick with something for a while so we can actually get through it. It seems like we're always changing. But all that data is in one place, and you can pull out a student sheet. And I am aware that we have schools that are getting very deep.
Member Grove.
So I had a question for Mark about truncated amount of time teachers have to prepare for the students. And to your mind, what would be an ideal length of time that teachers would spend preparing for this test? What does that look like?
Well, I don't think it's so much about a test prep thing. I think it was about setting up the technology, getting the computer set up, getting the headphones. It was that piece of it, because those pieces all came very late to us.
Yeah.
So it was just that, you know, scheduling to move the computers around and those types of pieces. Knowing if we had enough bandwidth in a school to run the assessment. That type of stuff is what happened late.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just prompting another question. I hope going down the road that, you know, we always hear the complaints that the teachers are teaching to the test, that this is not going to happen, that now we're going to look at our test results and we're going to just focus in on that, because elementary, I hear from a lot of parents that science and the other subject, social studies, is pretty much left to the wayside because all they're doing is the math and reading and writing. So I'm hoping that a child is going to get an overall education and not just focus so our test results go up.
Absolutely. I agree 100%. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So a motion would be that we can cleanse these results and bring them back to the board at the next meeting. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Committee Member Bowden. Discussion?
What do you mean by cleanse?
Take the zeros out.
I'm sorry.
What do I mean by friends? So that the common parent could understand what was just said.
Okay.
Because if you understood, I I might call you tomorrow and have you come in and explain it to me.
And we're going to have the data, if I, and maybe the chairman, that if you had problems in the schools, that's going to be noted, and take the zeros out, see how the scores work.
Maybe more Connors.
Thank you. What information will the state be showing the public? Will they be showing the information you just gave us? Will they be breaking it down by schools in the same way?
I'm not sure how they're going to present, like they used to do the accountability. We could actually go on the charts and see the whole recap report. We can find out and get back to you. So.
The only other thing, I did have the same question in my head before coming here tonight, in case someone asked it. So I went on the DOE website, and there is just a one-page release by Virginia Barry that's posted on the DOE page. So
what does it say?
I did make a copy of it.
Might have been the one I read earlier.
Okay, so, but I can leave it here for anyone who wants to look at it or whatnot.
The long and the short of it, what's it say? But I'll read the whole thing.
It just said that it was just basically baseline, and that was it. There was no question about that, not to compare it to MECAP. It was baseline, and it was more talking to the type of test that it was, so.
So parents will have to be aware that there might be two sets of data that are coming out, one set from the state about Manchester and one set that we have filtered in Manchester.
Can't be.
Well, you've just asked them to clean up that data, which will show different things, then it'll show different results than the state shows.
I would hope that what they came up with would be an easier explanation for people to understand what those results mean, because...
So are you asking for them to pull out the zeros or not?
I'm asking them to pull out the zeros. I'm asking them to pull out the ones, you know, that the anomalies that were in there at Beach or anywhere else that would have brought the numbers down to where they were at 7%. Obviously, they were that low at Wilson. What caused it at Wilson? Same thing?
Right. So I'm just saying, so our parents have to be aware that there will be two sets of information out there, the base information that the state has and then the information that we have been able to clarify for
I don't know that the state would report it out by school anyway. Okay. They probably just do a big grade level, and they may not even go as deep as the claim. They may just do an overall. It's just a baseline. They're not going to really put a lot of weight into it.
Can I do a question before the motion?
Go ahead.
Given the fact that you're, you know, been living in this world for a long time, do you have any... living in the data world, this particular...
Oh, okay, thank you.
Do you have and I'm all for, you know, advocating and, you know, clarity and making sure people understand this, but do you have any concerns about pulling out zeros or any type of cleansing? Are there any red flags that you feel would come out of that?
I think that... In my opinion, and Donna will probably have a different opinion, that's why we're a good team together, she looks at it mathematically, I look at it holistically, data can tell you whatever you want it to tell you, right? So depending on how you look at it, you're going to look at it for a purpose. So if you, whatever your question has that you're trying to answer, if you want to know what it looks like without the zeros, then you can know that. If you want to know... I don't know how much time was spent on a computer or students taking a test, then that's what you want to know about it. You know, it's just whatever you want to know.
Okay.
So
do you think that, you know, educators, principals were aware of how the zeros would affect this reporting? Do you think that was communicated beforehand, or did we not even...
Probably, I'm sure. I mean, we always knew if someone didn't take a test, it... Like,
because, you know, I don't know if that would have, you know, affected... You know, motivation and participation, I'm not sure, but, you know, pride for a school.
It's something new that had a lot of controversy attached to it, so everybody makes the best choice they can in a scenario like that. You know, I don't think that the blame game or pointing fingers or anything like that really makes a difference.
And that's not what I'm doing.
It just is what it is, and it's an okay thing.
So, no, they haven't been made aware, they weren't aware of it, or you think they were? Do you think they were aware of how the zeros would affect
the
numbers ahead of time?
Oh, I'm sure.
Well, at least they knew, though. I mean, at least people knew.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to speak to the motion a little bit. Talking about cleansing the data as someone who works with data, that makes me very uncomfortable.
Vote against the motion.
And yes, but I wanted to speak to why I want to vote against the motion. I will vote against the motion, Mr. Mayor. I'm voting against the motion because I think it's important that we do provide more information. Further information, so what does this look like without the with the zeros taken out, but not changing or quote-unquote fixing or cleansing existing data, because I think reasons that it's very hard to attach causes, as you had spoken to, at least that's what I heard earlier, to why certain schools did well. You can't say necessarily that, you know, it may have been what the kid didn't or student did or didn't have for breakfast, or it may have been the fact that they're having computer issues. If you say we're going to take this out because they had computer issues, I don't think that that necessarily serves our purpose well. If we want to provide more context, if we want to put an asterisk there, great. But cleansing or fixing data makes me deeply uncomfortable, and that's why I'm going to vote against it.
I just want to give my 2 cents on that. Cleansing the data is, as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't mean we're fudging the numbers. I think the public should be aware. If I was a student that got 100 on a test, and there was two students, myself and another student, and that parent, which was the parent's choice to opt out. Principals had no say in it. And I respect the parent's opinion to opt out of the test. But if I was a student, got 100, and there was two people in my class, and the other student opted out, it's going to reflect that I got a 50. That isn't fair to that student. It isn't fair to, for the school. So to say cleansing, I think we're giving a more realistic view of who took the test and what the numbers are. We already have the numbers out. Those are already public, what the numbers are with everybody included. So all we're doing now is looking at taking the numbers, with taking the zeros out, and if we had problems in the schools because of the computers and that, I think that, again, is an unrealistic number for that school if the reason why that number is low is because they had some type of computer problems. So I think I'm only speaking for myself. I don't think we're cleansing. I mean, we're giving data for the board to see who actually took the test and how efficient were those individuals that actually took the test.
I think you want to respond. I was just going to say, it seems to me that we should just put the data, both sets of data, side by side. So when it comes out, show this is what was presented tonight with a full scale. Here what it is with the modified scale, taking out the zeros and making notation of the difficulties in each school. That way everything's there. Nobody can say that we're hiding anything. And everybody gets to see what the real number would be. As Committeeman Beaudry is saying, when you take out, why are we counting people that didn't take the test in the school? Let's see what those that took the test did. But put both pieces of data in front of people and let them choose which one that they want to look at.
I agree with that. Committee Member Grove.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that would be a much better way to do that. The concern that I have is presenting this as the data that was presented tonight was not correct, and that the data that we're presenting now is the right data. I think it's different ways of looking at the data that we have. And I think, as Committeeman Avard suggested, having both of those together and saying, look, this is two ways of looking at this, and it helps you get some context on what might be happening in individual schools. That makes a lot more sense to us than us as a political body saying we want to look at it a certain way. That really colors what you might be able to see from that and saying that this is the right data. If you have both of those, you go, okay, here's another way to give some context to parents and the press or whoever else you want to give context to.
Without
having the slides up, though, isn't it true
at
as Ms. Cohen has mentioned, that we're reporting those students who scored at levels 3 and 4, which factors out the zero scores?
We're going to have to double check. For example, Memorial had a 46% on one of those categories, yeah. And if only 36% took the test, that doesn't work.
We have to double check that.
It's also a weighted average. So different things. Yeah, so
yeah. I mean, I can always get to the middle school ones at the moment.
Okay, we have a motion before us. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No. Opposed.
Roll call.
Committee Member Beaudry?
Yes.
Committee Member Avard?
Yes.
Committee Member Morosha is absent. Committee Member Van Houten?
No.
Committee Member Ambrosi and Lane are both absent. Committee Member Brough?
No.
Committee Member Bradley is absent. Committee Member Rokas is absent. Committee Member Bergeron?
No.
Committee Member Tessier?
No.
Committee Member Staub?
No.
Committee Member Terrio is absent. Committee Member Connors?
No.
Committee Gatsas?
Yes.
Motion fails.
Yes, ma'am, would you like a motion?
Okay, what's your motion?
One motion is to do as Avard suggested, that would present the two sets of data that we're interested in looking at, and make that available to the public in a way that this previous motion addressed.
What was the difference in the motion that I just made?
The difference in the motion was really, was fairly clear, was saying...
Okay, very good. You're an analysis then, I can tell.
I'll second.
One set of data side by side, is that...
Two different sets of data side by side.
So they'll always be presented side by side.
Yeah, so we aren't saying this is the right view or the wrong view, it's, hey...
One view and another view.
And going forward, I mean, are we making a trend that this is how we'll always present it, or that this is going to be...
We don't even know if we're gonna be taking this test in the future, so let's take one step at a time.
Well, oftentimes you do something once and then it becomes the trend.
That's what we should have done, not taken this test. We'd have been better off.
I voted against it.
Okay, you have a motion and a second. Somebody second, committee member Avery, all right, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Motion to adjourn?
No move.
Committee member Bowden, second by committee member Avery, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.